Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, when you talk about holiness, this passage, Ephesians 1:4 and Ephesians 2:8. In fact, it's very interesting. Ephesians 1:4 says that, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. The word of God is telling us that we were chosen to be holy. And again, this illustrates how we can misunderstand the scriptures to our own detriment. But when you look at this, Ephesians 2:8 and 9, it says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And that is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Not a result of works, so that no one may boast. And everyone will shout at you. If you are talking about righteousness, if you are talking about holiness, you are talking about works. Because of that scripture. But if they will just go to the previous chapter and look at it, the Bible is saying that we were not chosen because we were holy, but we were chosen to be holy. We were not saved because we were holy, but we were saved to be holy. Those not able to become holy have failed the purpose of salvation. But then, you see, almost every charismatic and whatever is telling you that, no, we have the righteousness of Christ. We don't have to do anything. And some even will teach that if you sin, it doesn't matter anymore because you are saved by grace. But the Bible is telling us, just a few verses before, is telling us that we were saved to be holy. I just want to use this to illustrate that, in fact, we have a responsibility to be holy. And if we are not holy, we'll have ourselves to blame. That means that you and I, before the Messiah comes, we must know what holiness means. We must know why we have to be holy. We must know how we can be holy. We must know when we are supposed to be holy. We must know what if we are not holy. And we must know what is the evidence of holiness. How will we know that we are holy? How will we know? We must know all this if you are going to be holy. Because we are responsible to be holy. We remember, we were chosen to be holy and blameless before him. Hallelujah. And if you thought that holiness is enough, now you know that you have to add blamelessness. And we have explained that it's the holiness that is blameless before the Lord. Amen. Okay. Again, those who stand before Jehovah on that day must be what? Holy. It says, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. So the Bible is here distinguishing between holiness, blamelessness, and above reproach. That should ring a bell. That should tell us that, look, the Bible has specific meaning for holiness. The Bible has specific meaning for blamelessness. The Bible has specific meaning for someone who is above reproach. Of course, you cannot be holy if you are not above reproach. But then we must understand what those things mean. Holy means that you are morally and ethically pure, separated from all defilement. Are we separated from all defilement? Do we watch things that are defiling? Do we watch things that belong to the world? Are we speaking like people who belong to the world? Are we subscribing to some concepts, some ideas, some principles, some cultures, some music that are of the world? What type of holiness? Is it the holiness before the Lord or the holiness according to my understanding? Blameless means that without spot or blemish. In fact, blameless means that, you know, if it is pure white, it is pure white. Pure white, not even a spot. And as someone has said, the more whiter the material is, the more its ability to show the smallest, the pink tip spot. Amen. Above reproach, you cannot be as accused of anything, nothing to blame for. I just want to tell you that this is the standard of the Lord. But those, it says, once has God spoken, and twice have I heard that power belongs to the Lord. When you hear the word of God, power is released. So somebody will hear this, will receive it, and power will be released to that person, in the person's spirit, in the person's soul, to become blameless. The Lord, He knows that you and I, we cannot achieve this. We cannot by any effort of our imagination. We cannot. That is why He sends His word. But the way He says, be careful how you hear. You remember Jesus saying that? He says, be careful how you hear. For the measure you use, the same measure will be used in giving to you. Hallelujah. Today somebody will hear and somebody will be holy, blameless, and above reproach on the day of the coming of the Messiah. Amen. Hallelujah. Now you look at this. It says, strive for peace with everyone and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. From the scriptures, in fact, if you look at the scriptures related to the kingdom of God, to the rapture, to eternity, you can see that all that matters is holiness, righteousness, purity, and blamelessness. You look at the scriptures related to the kingdom of God, to the rapture, and to eternity. I mean, there are certain things which are important. But when it comes to eternity, when it comes to the rapture, certain things are more important. Please. Yes, God loves you, but are you holy? Yes, it is true. God loves us. But the question on that day is, are you holy? No one will ask you, does God love you? That will not be a question. That will not be an issue. The issue on that day is, are you holy? You are saved by grace, yes, but are you holy? You are saved by faith, yes, but are you holy? That is the question. You see, as transcendent as the love of God is, as transcendent as the grace of God is, as essential as faith is, without holiness on our part, all this cannot save a person from everlasting destruction. That is what you are saying. That is what the Lord is saying. Yes, He loves us. That one, there's no doubt about it. In fact, we don't even discuss it. It is taken. It's given. The cross is a testimony. In fact, incredible love of God. So we don't even discuss it. It's given. But are you holy? Are you holy? That is the question. Not only that. Philippians 2:14, 15 and 16. It says, do all things without grumbling and complaining or disputing. So those of us who complain at almost everything in this world, we have our own opinion. If it is not according to our opinion, according to our own understanding, it is not right. It says that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. So the Lord is saying that in addition to innocence, you must be blameless. Now, when someone is innocent, he says that he's not guilty of any wrongdoing, not guilty of sin. And he says, that is not enough. You must also be blameless. So that tells me that the five foolish virgins not taking oil, extra oil, may not be seen as such, but it's blameable. It doesn't have to be seen by our definition. But it can be blameable. Wow. Hallelujah. Since the children of God are innocent and blameless, the world will acknowledge that we are God's children when they can find nothing to accuse us of moral blame. Any moral fault or blame will cancel out our belonging to God as His children. That is what that scripture says. That you may be blameless and innocent, children of God. So, the children of God must be blameless and innocent. So if you are not blameless and innocent, we cannot enter into the kingdom of God. May the Lord have mercy on us. And He says that we must stand out from the world. We must stand out from the world. And it is only when we are innocent and blameless that we can stand out of the world. And if somebody is hearing, you are hearing that the Lord is giving you power to stand out from the world. You are hearing that the Lord is giving us power to be innocent and blameless. You are hearing that the Lord is putting to death the grumbling and the disputing and the complaining and the murmuring in our hearts. That is what the Lord is doing. As you receive this word, that, oh, I must be innocent and blameless, and I must stop grumbling and complaining and murmuring and disputing. As you receive that, the Lord is putting to death that sin, that defilement, that spot, that stain, that blemish. Hallelujah. So be careful how you listen. That's what Jesus says. Be careful how you hear. For the measure you use, the same measure will be used to give to you. Somebody will be sitting there and say, ah, what is this? Blameless and holiness, are they not the same thing? This is too impossible. Somebody will say that I receive. Today, Lord, I want to be innocent and blameless. Hallelujah. It says you are witnesses. Not only that. You see, holy and blameless. Innocent and blameless. Now listen to this. It says you are witnesses and God also. How holy and righteous and blameless was our conduct toward you believers. He is making distinction between holiness, righteousness, and blamelessness. So you could see that there are various aspects of this holiness requirement that God is asking of us. We may lump all of them into one thing, but God says that they are different, and each and every one is important. They were consecrated to God. So holy means that they were consecrated to God in their attitudes and conduct. They separated themselves from common or defiling things. They lived a life consistent with the gospel. That is being righteous. And their manner of living was fully pleasing to the Lord. And there was nothing which could be laid to their charge by anyone. Wow. So, if you have devoted yourself, you say you are a pastor. You say you are evangelist. You say you are whatever, an apostle, prophet. And you are doing the work of God. Is your life consistent, fully consistent with the gospel? If not, you are not righteous. Or if there's something your wife or your husband can say against you, you are not blameless. You may be devoted wholly in the eyes of God. You may have stopped all the fornication and all that. But are you righteous? And are you blameless? Also. Hallelujah. Today the Lord is taking us to another level. Amen? Says, yes, you are saints. Saints means that you are holy. The Lord, he calls us saints. But he says that, I want righteous, blameless saints now. Amen? You have been called to be righteous, blameless saints. Amen. Hallelujah. Which tells me that there are blamable saints. The Bible says that only a few will be saved. And we all want to be what? Righteous, blameless saints, don't we? Amen. Amen. May the Lord bless you. Amen. Look at another one. It says, now may God of peace, 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wow. So you can see that, again, the holiness is a comprehensive type of holiness. And it's about blamelessness, not only holiness. So blameless in attitudes and habits, blameless in thought, desires, imaginations, and blameless in our actions and choices. The dressing, the tidiness, the friendships, you know. You may be holy because you are not doing certain things. Or you may be righteous because you are not doing certain things. But who are your friends? And we were talking about gossip the other time. Proverbs 17 verse 4. See, he who tells and he who listens. In fact, the one who listens is an evildoer. And the one who lends his ears or her ears to gossip is a liar. You haven't spoken, but the Lord says that you are a liar. The things we do with our body. Do we dress like the worldly people? How do we keep ourselves? How do we groom ourselves? They are all important. Holiness by definition. In fact, there are various aspects of holiness. One aspect is that is sanctification. That is separation from everything that defiles. Sanctification means separation. Sanctified means set apart, devoted, consecrated. A holy person is separated from everything that defiles. A holy person is separated from everything that defiles. And then you see why the Lord wants us to separate from the things of the world and the things of the flesh. A holy person is fully devoted to God, consecrated unto God, and is not available for profane use. In fact, if you are devoted to God, there are certain things you cannot do. And if you do them, you are not holy. And of course, you walk according to the word of God. There's moral purity. So there is nothing that is defiling in your life. So you can see the reason why I put this slide in is for us to see, I mean, after holiness, separated from everything that defiles, completely devoted to God, walking according to the word of God, that is not enough. That is not enough. That is not enough. And blamelessness takes holiness to another level. It says that you are faultless, guiltless. In every area, you are clean, untarnished, spotless, and blemished. Absence of eternal blemish or external spot. So by nature, in your heart of hearts, you are pure. You know how you have not stolen because you haven't seen somebody's $10,000 on the ground yet. But if you saw somebody's $10,000 on the ground, you will go rejoicing. You go away rejoicing. Because your pocket will be heavy. So you can see that internally, the blemish there. You may not even know, even till the day you die. You are a thief. But you do not know. You haven't had the opportunity to steal. But what you are saying, that blamelessness is where there is no stealing, there's no lying, there's nothing in the heart. So you can give opportunity, as much opportunity. Jesus gives us a good example. He came to save sinners. Sinners rejected him. We killed him. We tortured him. We abused him. The only thing he can say is that, Father, forgive them. In his agony, in his pain, in his shame and his disgrace, when he was hanging there naked, the only thing that can come out of him is that, Father, forgive them. That is what you are talking about here. Internally, there was no malice, no hatred, no nothing evil in Jesus. The Lamb of God without defect. The Lamb of God without defect. And he says that that is what he has called us. Your wife coughs and you are angry. Your husband trips and falls down and you are angry. And you call yourself a Christian. I am saved by grace. Saved by what? What grace? Which salvation? You understand? Eternally what? No blemish. Externally, what you and I can see? Perfect. May the Lord help us. Amen. The Bible says that blameless in holiness. And as you can see from the definition of blameless and holiness, they are the same, isn't it? So I see a double emphasis. I see no compromise, and perfect holiness, comprehensive holiness, is what God is looking for. By combining blamelessness with holiness, blamelessness with innocence, blamelessness with purity, blamelessness with righteousness, and the two, the pair, are the same. So it is called emphasis. It means that he's very serious about it. May the Lord help us. Amen. When it comes to the rapture, as we've said before, we need blamelessness. And the blamelessness is the character of those who enter the rapture. From Revelation 19, verse 7 and 8. It says, let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. How did the bride make herself ready? It says, it was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. So when the bride puts on the fine linen, bright and pure, she was ready. And he says that this, then for those who say that we have the righteousness of Christ, so we don't need to be righteous ourselves, he says, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. Hallelujah. It was granted unto us to put on righteousness. Righteousness. And we'll soon see, we'll talk a little bit more about that. Blamelessness is the garment for the wedding feast of the Lamb of God. So if you are not blameless, you should forget about heaven. Hallelujah. Remember, the Lord, in presenting blamelessness before us here, is presenting the power of God. You know how, you look into the scriptures, they are there. God calls people to bless them, and he presents it at times as a duty, as something they must do, something they must obey. But when they do those things, he releases his blessing into their lives. And it's the same here today. Blamelessness, or the garment of the bride, is for those who have triumphed over sin. Those who have overcome what? Death. Those who have been reconciled with God. So if you have the garment of blamelessness, it means that you have accepted the price Jesus paid for your salvation. If you have the garment of blamelessness, it means that you have been restored to God. You have been faithful to God, and you are hostile to sin. So if there is no blamelessness in your life, then it means that you are still under the power of sin. You have not overcome death. So you can see how important blamelessness is in our salvation. In our salvation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How can blamelessness be possible? We have God's path. There's a path only God can do, and we cannot do it. We cannot. And there is a path, our path, which God will not do it. God will not do it. God will not obey his word for you. God will not obey his word for me. I have to obey. The key point is that he will hold us accountable if we do not do our part. If we do not do our part. Hallelujah. In terms of what God's part, look at, in fact, it's very encouraging. It says, listen. It says, now to him who is able. Amen. To him who is able. Amen. Amen. He is able. He is able. We are not able, but he is able. It says, to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless. Hallelujah. I must know this one. And I must know him. I must know him. Him who is able. This one who is able, I must know him. I must know what he wants from me, that he will do what he alone can do. Amen. He says he is able to keep us from stumbling and to present us blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. Hallelujah. He is able. There is good news for us. Amen. The word of God always comes with the power of God. He says that there is someone who is able to keep us from stumbling. And today, as we make our mind, oh, so blamelessness is required of me, that I may enter into the kingdom of God. Father, I receive your word. He says, as soon as we receive his word, the one who is able, he enters into our lives. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says that he's able to keep us from stumbling. And he will take us, he is able. Whether Jesus comes in the next 50 years, or 100 years, or 70 years, he is able to keep us from stumbling until we enter. And to present us blameless, amen, before the presence, hallelujah, of his glory with great joy. The only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, amen, majesty, amen, dominion, amen, and authority, amen, before all time and now and forever. Amen. Hallelujah.
Mighty Jesus is only you. You are able.
Mighty Jesus, it's only you. You are able.
Amen. Now listen to another one. 1 Corinthians 1:7 says, so that you are not lacking in any gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. So you can see that the Father and the Son, they are committed to make us blameless. Amen. Hallelujah. On that day of the rapture, the Father and the Lord, our Redeemer himself, they are committed. He says he will confirm you. He said that, yes, he is blameless. Amen. Hallelujah. The standard remains blamelessness. The standard remains blamelessness. But only God is able to make us blameless for the rapture. Amen. He says that the standard, he will not change it. But help, he will give us. Those who receive his word, he will help them to make it. Amen. But the standard, he will not change it. Hallelujah. Amen. Lord, help me. So today, he says, you who alone are able, help me. Help me. Keep me from stumbling. Present me blameless before the presence of your glory. Amen. With great joy. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But there is our part. And you look at this. 2 Peter 3:13. See, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwells righteousness. Since there will be many heavens, but only one earth. I don't know what the heavens will be for, but the Lord says that there will be heavens, but one earth. Amen? Maybe some people will dwell in heaven, and others will dwell in the new earth. I don't know. I don't know. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that you are looking for such things, be diligent that you may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. So this is our part. Now, diligent means that work hard, be careful, be watchful, be persistent, do not be lazy. So you can see that lazy, easy Christianity. I go to church on Sunday and all the other days I am who I want to be. I want to enjoy life. Christian, there's liberty in Christ. I get up, I sleep, I eat, I chop, and that is it. I'm a Christian. I'm born again by faith, by grace. Just forget it. It says it takes work, hard work. Be watchful. It takes persistence. You push, it is not pushing. You keep on pushing, you keep on pushing, you keep on pushing until it gives way. There is an issue you are not happy with. You go to the Lord, Lord, help me. And he says that somebody went to a friend's house. He says, I have got a visitor. Can you give me a loaf of bread for my visitor? I said, nah, me and my children, we are sleeping. Go somewhere else. Says, if you will not get up because you are his friend, you get up because you keep on. Says, men ought to pray and not to give up. Persistence. No laziness. When it's time to come to prayer meeting, oh, you have worked too hard for the week, so you are not coming. A day is coming when it's only blamelessness. Is not your hard work at work. It's not your children. It's not your husband. It's not your wife. It is your blamelessness. And he says that you must work very hard for your blamelessness. Amen. You spend 40 hours a week, but you must also work hard for our blamelessness. Because on that day, nothing else will matter except blamelessness. You know, you can be holy and not blameless. You can be righteous and not blameless. You can be pure and not blameless. You can be innocent and not blameless. But if you are blameless, you are holy. If you are blameless, you are pure. If you are blameless, you are righteous. If you are blameless, you are innocent. And that is why it says, let us be diligent that we'll be found to be blameless. Amen. Hallelujah. It says, as obedient children, do not conform to the passions of your former ignorance. It says, in time past, we did not know. We acted in ignorance. We knew only half truth, half of the scriptures, and we thought that was it. And we acted in the passions of our former ignorance. But as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. By the way, let me tell you this. When the Bible says we must be holy, it's not talking about partial holiness. You hear many people say that holiness is not possible. It's not talking about sinless perfection. I don't know about that. The Bible defines holiness and then it adds on top blamelessness. So we must go back to the one who is saying it, that he may help us to attain it. That is a wiser thing to do than to just conclude that, me, I can't do it, so it is not possible. That is not what God meant. You know, if you cannot do it, you ask him to help you. Don't say that because I cannot do it, that is not what you are saying. You understand? It says, as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. And then he says this. So this one is for Christians. If you call on him as Father, who judges impartially according to each one's deeds. Yes, each one's works. Yeah. Says that is what he will use to judge. Salvation is not by works, but entering into the kingdom of heaven depends on what we do or we don't do. May the Lord have mercy. It says, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Those who are saved are called obedient children. They obey. Now you understand. Okay, we'll get to that one. And are expected not to live as unbelievers or those not saved. We are commanded to be holy in all our conduct as the Father is holy. We will be judged impartially according to our deeds, according to our works. Not the works we've done before salvation, but the works we have done after salvation. You will be judged. That is what the scripture is saying. So what is our part? So now we know that first, we must be diligent to be blameless. Second, we are called to be holy. And we are saying that the holiness that the Lord is telling us about today is blameless in holiness. It's not just holiness, but blameless, holy and blameless. So how do we do that? And we have said that the blamelessness we are talking about is a garment for the rapture, the garment of salvation, the robe of righteousness. And the Bible is telling us how we can do that, our part. It says, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God, in true righteousness and holiness. So the question is, how do we put on or maintain the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness? Because the Bible is saying that this true righteousness and holiness is blamelessness. Is blamelessness. This is the garment that we have received for the wedding supper of the Lamb, for the kingdom of God. The Bible in Romans 6:16 tells us, do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to seek righteousness. Hallelujah. So the Bible is telling us that we must present ourselves as slaves to what? Obedience. And it says that obedience, when we obey, it will lead to what? Hallelujah. So at least we've got one. Righteousness and blamelessness. Then verse 19 of Romans 6 also tells us that slave to righteousness unto holiness. It says, I speak in the manner of men because of the weakness of your flesh. For as you have yielded your members as slaves to uncleanness and to lawless act unto lawlessness, even so now yield your members as slaves to righteousness unto. So when we yield our members to obedience, obedience leads to what? Righteousness. And righteousness leads to holiness. And I've told you about the story of a very great big man, somebody who calls himself a man of God, who says that, somebody asks him, what is holiness? Since holiness is where God is, and since God lives in you, you are holy. That is fantastic, isn't it? Very, very. It says, wherever God is holy. And if you are a Christian, God lives in you. Therefore, you are holy. It doesn't matter what you do. You are holy. That's a good definition, isn't it, of holiness. But the Bible says that it is only when we submit ourselves to righteousness that we receive the holiness of God. And the Bible one makes more sense than the other one, isn't it? Yeah. This one is true. Because if you do the right thing, you do not defile yourself with sin, with disobedience. Hallelujah. And then the Bible says that, it says, now you have been freed from sin and have become God's slaves. This results in a holy life, that is sanctification, and finally in everlasting life. So you can see that faith leads to what? Salvation. And salvation enables us to obey God. And in obedience to God, we put on the righteousness of Christ that has been given to us. And as we put on the righteousness of Christ that has been given to us, we become holy. And when we are holy, the Bible says that it leads to what? Eternal life. And this one, when we put on the righteousness of Christ, which also includes blamelessness, then we have the righteous and blameless, holy and blameless, and then that one will give us eternal life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, you see, the Lord is telling us that for us to be blameless, our attitude towards His word must change. He says, in fact, let's go back. He says, we must present ourselves as obedient slaves to the word of God. That is what we must do. Obedient slaves. You don't have a choice. You don't grumble. You don't murmur. You don't complain. We are just what? Obedient slaves to the word of God. Amen. In the same way that when we were in sin, we presented ourselves as obedient slaves. Let's go to the pub. We are happy that we are going to the pub. If it is going to the disco, we are happy that we are going to the disco. If it is drinking, we are happy that we are drinking. Obedient slaves. Rejoicing in whatever you were doing. Hallelujah. But now, if the Lord says that, wow, you must be blameless in holiness. Wow, thank you, Father, that I now know how I can enter. Blameless in holiness. Thank you, Father. Release every word, every grace in your word. I receive your word. I receive the grace in your word. I receive the spirit in your word. I receive the power in your word. I receive the wisdom in your word. Father, let your word be established in my heart. Bless your word into my heart. In the mighty name of Jesus. And then go away and obey. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When we talk about salvation, we need to get it right. When we talk about salvation, it means that we are saved from sin, the guilt of sin, the power of sin, and the future penalty of sin. And if this one, the guilt or the power of sin, is in our lives, it means that there is no salvation from the future penalty of sin. There's no eternal life for us. You understand? So salvation means that there's no guilt. We have received the forgiveness of Christ. The power of sin has been broken, and therefore there's no future penalty of sin awaiting us. It means also that we have been delivered from the spirit of disobedience and we are no longer slaves to sin. So we do not, as one of the prayer was saying, we do not debate the word of God. We do not argue with God. In fact, we are slaves to righteousness now. It means that we have died to sin, no longer attracted to sin, and no longer find pleasure in sin. That is what salvation means. It also means that we love righteousness. We take delight in obedience to God. And as I was saying, oh, let us go and drink. Then we were happy. We'll go and work the whole week and take our money and go and drink and vomit in the street. We were happy doing that. Next week, we are looking forward to it. We had pleasure in sin. But now, if we are saved, we delight in obedience to God. Amen. So a complete changeover. And we desire to live a life that pleases Him. And now we hate sin. That is what salvation means. That is what salvation means. And until and unless these are in our lives, we are not saved yet. We must go back to the Lord to help us and to save us. The evidence of salvation is a holy or blameless life. And as we said, if you have faith and you are saved, this must follow. Sin came through disobedience. We were not capable of obedience, so holiness was not possible. When we sinned, it was because we disobeyed God. And after we had sinned, we were not capable of obedience anymore. But the salvation that Christ Jesus gives us enables us to obey God. So now obedience is a choice. Obedience doesn't come automatically. Previously, disobedience was automatic. You don't have to teach a child how to sin. We will sin by being human beings. But now that situation has changed. Now obedience has become a choice and disobedience has also become a choice. So we choose which one we do. Through obedience to the word of God, the Holy Spirit prepares us and holiness is now possible. We do not have to generate blamelessness. We have to use what has been given to us. So it is not me who is going to generate blamelessness. That garment that Christ Jesus has given me, that righteousness of Christ Jesus is blamelessness. I have to use it. I have to put it on. And I put it on by choosing obedience. Am I making sense? Hallelujah. Just want to end by this. That we are not on our own. Heaven is behind us. Heaven is interested in our blamelessness. Heaven has invested in our blamelessness. Heaven is working to make us blameless on the day of the Lord. Heaven, the whole of heaven, every power in heaven, every authority in heaven, every resource in heaven. In fact, the executive officer of heaven has relocated onto the earth because of you and I. The Holy Spirit has been given instructions from God the Father. Go and prepare them. Do not come up until you have finished. The Bible says that he is on this earth until the day of the rapture when he will be taken away. He will be transferred only when the saints are gone. Heaven is very serious to make us blameless. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And him who is able, he is committed to make us blameless. But not only that, he says that he also will confirm us unto the end. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is good news today. The good news is that the Lord has told us how we may enter. He's teaching us, in fact, maybe the Lord knows that we are holy. And he's taking us to the next step, isn't it? Maybe the Lord knows that we have stopped the fornication. We have stopped the murdering. We have stopped the anger. We have stopped the stealing. We have stopped the lying, the gossiping. Maybe he says that now they are ready to go to the next step. The final step. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So today I present to you the next step in our journey towards the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. He says the next stop is blameless in holiness. And there's another good news. He says there is one who is able to prevent us from stumbling and to present us before God the Father on that day in great joy. Hallelujah. Awesome God. Can we stand up, please? How great you are. You are God. Mighty are your miracles. We stand in awe of your holy name. Lord, we bow down and worship you. The Ephesians 4:24 that we read, if you go up a little bit to verse 22, it says, put off your former self. Maybe some of us have not been blameless in some of the things that we have done. Maybe we have not been blameless in some of our attitudes and our habits. Maybe we have not been blameless. Holiness, maybe we've got it. But the blamelessness, we have not understood it. Yes, we are saints of God. We are holy before the Lord. The blood of Jesus testifies on our behalf. But maybe we have got ourselves entangled in the things of the world. Maybe not so much physically, but our hearts are still after or engaged with the things of this world. And he who looks at the heart, who judges us according to our heart, he wants our heart to be blameless also. And today, before we continue, I just want to give you the opportunity to repent before the Lord. He who is able to make you blameless. He who is able to make us blameless. I want to give you the opportunity to repent before the Lord. It says, in body, soul, and spirit, according to what he sees in our hearts. If you want to repent before the Lord, please come forward. He says, he will not change it. The standard he will not change. The standard he will not change. But he will help us. 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 He will not change the standard. But he said, there's one who is able. I am coming, Lord. Coming unto you. He says he will judge us according to our deeds. He says he will do it impartially. I am coming, Lord. Please sing unto the Lord. He says he's able, he's able. Heaven has invested so much in us. Heaven doesn't want the investment to go waste. The blood of Jesus is the ultimate price in the whole universe, in eternity. They killed him. He who cannot die. He died for you and I. The glorious one. They put him to shame. They disgraced him. For you and I. He has invested his glory for your salvation, for your blamelessness. He has sacrificed his glory for your blamelessness, for my blamelessness. He has sacrificed his holiness. He says, God made him to be sin, who knew no sin, that we might have the righteousness of God. He sacrificed his holiness. I am coming, Lord. Coming unto you. Wash me, cleanse me by the blood that flowed. Want to sing it once? I am coming, Lord. Cry out to the Lord. He alone can help us. Now he can help us. A time is coming when he will withdraw his help, when the grace will be no more. Him who is able, he is here today. I am coming, Lord. Have mercy upon my soul, Lord. I have not been blameless. I have been lazy. I have been procrastinating. Your kingdom is languishing, and I'm building the kingdom that I will not take away. Please let us say this together. I have heard your word. Please forgive me. Please wash me. Please renew me. And have mercy upon my soul. Fill me with him who is able, that I will be an obedient slave to holiness, an obedient slave to blamelessness. Establish your salvation in my life, in my family. Mighty name of Jesus, I ask with thanksgiving. Amen. Father, you have sent the power that created the universe. Father, we receive your word. And Father, thank you, Father, for disciplining us and guiding us and instructing us by your power to deliver us, Father, from sin, from disobedience. Your word that alone is able to restore unto us the garment of salvation, even as we submit to your word. That, Father, beginning from this day, you grant us a heart that is fixed on blamelessness, a heart that will pursue until it is filled with your blameless holiness in our lives. Lord, we are asking that. Father, you will grant us mercy before you. Father, let the blood of Jesus prevail in our lives. And let the blood of Jesus triumph in our eternal destiny. In Jesus' mighty name, we ask with thanksgiving. Amen. God bless you. Amen.